Hello everyone, thanks to everyone for watching this video. My name is Qi Dang. I am an architect and engineer. Today's video is titled Truss Layout Optimization, and it is going to provide you the fundamentals of mid-shell structures and also the layout optimization with transmissible loads. I am going to give you an overview of what I am covering in today's video. First at all, it is a bit of background to the topic, and then focus on the truss layout optimization and the work examples before wrapping up with conclusions. The success of any project depends on starting with a good concept. For the design of structural steel trusses and other structures, the geometrical arrangement of the members is often the most important consideration in producing an efficient and well-behaved design. This slide shows some of the truss geometries of minimal load path structures included in Mitchell's 1904 paper. Because Mitchell approached the problem from the point of view of continuum mechanics, it should be noted that the solutions permit an infinite number of elements, similar to the spokes of the bicycle wheel-like subsystems in some of the Mitchell trusses. Nevertheless, Mitchell trusses are quite useful because they provide insight into optimal geometries and are benchmarks of the shortest possible load paths for a given structure. In the design of practical trusses, however, the final structures are composed of a finite number of elements. Thus, it is useful to look at the discretized versions of these optimal solutions, commonly referred to as discrete Mitchell trusses or discrete optimal trusses. However, in the early 20th century, it is very difficult to compute those optimal structures. Until the 1960s, those minimum volume structures could be identified computationally. The mathematical optimization problem is a very simple linear programming problem, as first outlined by mathematicians Dong, Gomery, and Greenberg. The objective function is to minimize the total volume of material, which is calculated by summing the cross-sectional areas of each member multiplied by its length, to ensure that the structure is able to carry the specified loads back to the supports. Various constraints are required. Firstly, the forces at each node must be in equilibrium. In other words, the total force at each node must sum to zero in both the horizontal and vertical directions. Secondly, each member must have a cross-sectional area that is large enough to carry the force being transmitted. This is calculated based on the given permitted limiting material stress in tension and compression, comprising m potential truss bars, n nodes, and a single load case. The standard formulations are shown in this slide. In this layout optimization procedure, the design domain is populated with nodes. These nodes are located at the intersections of grid lines, and at locations where the grid lines cross the edges of the design domain. If a load is applied at mid-span with pinned roller supports, the result of optimal layout is a half-circle shape. If the supports are pinned, the optimal result is a parabolic curve. In this case of pinned supports, the member arrangement of the single parabolic arch is located in two types of regions. The first type is that structurally rich forms in which generally orthogonal truss bars are strained to their respective limits in tension and compression. We call it as T type. The second type is simpler flexureless line and surface structures. We call it as R-type. T-type region contains adjoint strains in two orthogonal directions. Thus, optimized structure in this region usually have tension and compression members intersecting with each other at 90 degrees. R-type region contains adjoint strains of only one side in one direction. Thus, optimized structures in this region usually a single or parallel bars, all in tension R plus or all in compression R minus. Now we consider variation on the basic formulation in which further loads can be included which are allocated to groups of nodes rather than to individual nodes. This figure shows a load shared by two nodes A and B in the ground structure. In this case, additional nodal loads F waveline, which are linear programming variables, can be included, giving a revised equilibrium constraint B times Q minus F waveline equal to zero, assuming for simplicity that there are now only transmissible rather than fixed loads involved. Additional constraints also need to be introduced to ensure that the total load applied to a given group can be specified. The fully linear programming formulation for a problem involving transmissible loads can be written as a right-hand side. Now we can use the layout optimization with transmissible loads to analyze a simple example. This example involves vertical loads uniformly distributed along a horizontal line and free to migrate along the vertical lines, and is supported by two paned nodes at the left and the right bottom corners. Sum of the vertical loads is 1, and a 200 x 200 grid is used for discrete optimization. But for visual clarity, only a series of nodes is shown in this slide. When the ratio between compressive and tensile stress capacity is larger than 3, for example, sigma minus over sigma plus equal to 3, the optimal form is a funicular R structure. When the ratio is less than 3, for example, sigma minus over sigma plus equal to 1, T-region Hensky nets emerge adjacent to the supports. It is clearly to know the result of the strength and ratio larger than 3 is close to the theoretical optimal solution. Now we know the mathematical formulations of truss layout optimization. Next, we will show two examples to illustrate the applications of the layout optimization. The first example is Exchange House in London. Exchange House is a building bridge hybrid. Its form and structure are built on an exposed steel bridge spanning a long span rail yard. A platform arches over the train tracks, enabling the train station to function normally underneath a 10-story office building. For parallel structural arches, two expressed externally and two internally provide the building's skeleton, enabling column-free interior spaces. We now use the layout optimization to find an optimal form. To simplify calculations, the parameters 2 times L, H, and W are used to describe the span and height of the building and the width tributary to an arch. Z denotes the depth of the arch, and gamma is the average density of the building. In what follows, the self-weight of the building is equivalent to the uniformly distributed load. For sake of simplicity, the uniformly distributed load is separated at the top of each column. In the layout optimization, we assume the ratio between compressive and tensile stress capacity is 3. Then a single parabolic arch rib is obtained as shown in the right-hand side of this slide. The height of Z is approximately equal to root of 3 over 2 times L. The total load path of Exchange House involves columns, hangers, tie, and arch. Here, we also can see that the horizontal load path of the arch is equal to the horizontal load path of the adjacent tie plus the vertical load path of the adjacent hangers plus vertical load path of the columns that were eliminated when the arch system was used instead of sitting directly on the ground. The second example is combined braced frames. Braced frame structural system is commonly developed in the lateral design of high-rise buildings. Braced frames have been used in several noteworthy buildings like the John Hancock Center in Chicago, Broadgate Tower in London, and the Bank of China Tower in Hong Kong. The design of such a system is traditionally based on diagonal braces arranged according to a 45-degree or 60-degree angle, and the variations in between these two angles. However, there have been few engineering studies in the past to identify the optimal bracing angle and the parameters affecting such angles. Exploring optimal bracing layouts is to minimize volume or weight. There are 6 discrete members are added to model each column while maintaining the same total volume of material as the problem in this slide. This design domain subject to several loads at the left and right boundaries, with fixed pin supports at the bottom corners. For sake of simplicity, the connections between members are treated as pin joints. Edge column members are assumed to be pre-existing members which have infinite reserves of strength when functioning as part of a braced frame. In this case, the ratio between compressive and tensile stress capacity is assumed as 1. If the discrete nodes are only set on the edge columns, the optimal result is a cross-bracing frame. If the discrete nodes are added on the symmetry line, the optimal result is a Stoneberg bracing frame. In order to compare these two different types, we study a single module bracing. In this problem, two-pointed loads representing the wind lateral force acting on the frame is applied at the top left and right corners. The height of the design domain is given as h, the width as 2 times b, and the height of the bracing intersection point as z, letting us to set the height of the bracing point z be the design variable. We are looking for the optimal location that minimizes the deflection at the top of the structure, assuming each member to have a constant stress sigma. The tip deflection is delta equal to sigma times b over Young's modulus e times the summation of internal forces times length of all elements. We now assume that h is equal to 1 and it is also equal to 2 times b. The discrete members are shown in this slide. The intersection of the bracing was constrained to move along the center line of the module due to symmetry. The height ratio z over h was varied from 0.5 to 1, z being the distance of the brace work point from the base, and the corresponding tip deflection was calculated. The optimal z over h ratio, in other words, the one that minimizes the deflection at the top of the frame, is shown to be 0.75 times h in this slide. Thus, it is clearly to know the deflection of Stoneberg bracing is lower than cross bracing. The deflection is very important to the safety of the high-rise buildings. From conclusions, what we learned: truss layout optimization makes finding efficient layouts for complex problems accessible to the designer. A single parabolic arch rib under uniformly distributed load between pin supports has been used to illustrate the applications of the layout optimization. The methodology also presented in this work for developing a lateral braced frame system in a high-rise building enables the structural engineer to quickly and efficiently identify the optimal diagonal layout. Okay, thanks to everyone for watching my video today, and I do hope you found the video informative and that you learned some things from it. If you do have any questions, then you can write comments and messages. I am happy to answer any questions. Thanks for your watching.